Welcome to the broadcast tonight, constitutional law professor Laurence Tribe of Harvard Law School on the impeachment process moving to the Senate.
A impeachment decision by the House of Representatives that essentially represents the view of one political party is just not going to be accepted by the nation. I think the polling numbers just over the weekend made it clear that it's not going to be accepted, and history will view it rather negatively, just as history views negatively the impeachment of Andrew Johnson.
And Congressman Lee Hamilton evaluates the attacks against Iraq.
I think a person like Saddam Hussein, he's not dumb, he's not stupid, is very skillful in understanding when we do in fact have a credible use of force present. In the past, he's often backed down, but not invariably. But it does take this orchestrated effort between diplomacy on the one hand and a credible use of force and the willingness to use that force to achieve our objectives.
A conversation with actor Nick Nolte, one of the stars of The Thin Red Line.
The argument of Tall, the military man, saying, get the objective. If you don't get, if you stall, you die. Really, there's a self-interest driving underneath that. Staros is arguing the argument of human compassion. I don't want to jeopardize my man's life any more than I have to. The question is there any place on the battlefield for human compassion?
And editor Walter Isaacson of Time magazine on Time's selection of the men of the year.
Bill Clinton was the one who got into this mess, who evaded and cut corners and misled people, and Starr saw it, thought it was a crime, and pursued it not only into the Oval Office but into the private study. And so without both of them acting together, you wouldn't have had this drama.
Tribe, Hamilton, Nolte, and Isaacson when we continue.
Charlie Rose is made possible by USA Networks as part of our continuing commitment to innovative television. Through USA Network and the Sci-Fi Channel, we provide original entertainment to America and the world.
Anywhere, anytime, any book. BarnesandNoble.com, where the world shops for books.
Cisco Systems, the company that brought the internet to business, is pleased to help bring The Charlie Rose Show to PBS. Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide. From our studios in New York City, this is Charlie Rose.
Over the weekend, President Clinton became only the second president in U.S. history to be impeached by the House of Representatives. The matter now moved to the Senate, where a number of possibilities exist. This includes trial, conviction, and removal from office, as well as lesser penalties. In today's New York Times, former Presidents Gerald Ford and Jimmy Carter call for a bipartisan censure resolution. Joining me now for consideration of the legal and political implications of this weekend's events, Professor Laurence Tribe, constitutional law professor at Harvard University, joins us now from Boston. Welcome back.
Good to be here, Charlie.
Where do we go from here?
Well, I hope that saner heads will prevail in the Senate, that the almost extraordinarily vicious partisanship that tore things in such a radical direction in the House of Representatives will not be replicated in the Senate, that it will be a body that can more thoughtfully absorb suggestions like the one that former Presidents Carter and Ford have made. I think that we'll have to go through certain formal procedures no matter what. That is, it is very clear that the process of having the Chief Justice of the United States come over to the Senate and of having the charges presented by the managers from the House of Representatives, that ritual will have to be begun. But once it is begun, I don't think we are committed to a kind of national orgy of all Monica all the time with sort of a salacious kind of inquisition into sexual details. We don't have to go through that. It seems to me that everyone stands to gain, and no one really stands to lose, by an accommodation in which the president goes further than he has yet gone in essentially conceding that he deliberately misled the grand jury, though I'm sure that's not going to be easy for him since he doesn't think he did, and in which a joint censure resolution, which perhaps includes a voluntary payment by the president of some of the costs of the investigation, brings all of this to a bipartisan close. And that's what's critical, because a impeachment decision by the House of Representatives that essentially represents the view of one political party is just not going to be accepted by the nation. I think the polling numbers just over the weekend made it clear that it's not going to be accepted, and history will view it rather negatively, just as history views negatively the impeachment of Andrew Johnson.
Let me ask this. Does the process have to start because of constitutional reasons?
No. I think it's interesting. I've heard a number of senators say, as though they're reading some text that's invisible to me, that the Constitution says that when a bill of impeachment is presented by the House of Representatives, the Senate must begin a trial. It says nothing of the kind. The Constitution says that the House of Representatives has the sole power of impeachment, that the Senate has the sole power to try impeachments. The only mandate is that if the Senate does convict someone of a high crime and misdemeanor, then the person must be removed from office. That's the only must that could be found in the Constitution. So that if the Senate decided by a simple majority not to proceed with a trial, but simply to move in the direction of a mutually acceptable accommodation, a kind of super plea bargain, if you will, I see nothing in the Constitution that would stand in the way.
Then it could take place tomorrow.
It could in theory, although one would presumably want to wait until the 106th Congress, since a number of people are raising questions, some of them I think not well-founded, but enough to create a cloud one would not want to live under, about the binding effect in the next Congress of things that are done by the 105th.
I wanted to get to that, but you're there now. So tell me what you think. I mean, I read that the Clinton counsel is considering the idea that it is unconstitutional to go from one Congress to another Congress, not House to Senate, but one Congress elected one year and another Congress elected in this past November. And they may raise constitutional questions. Are you saying they have no grounds to stand on?
I'm afraid I'm saying they have no grounds to stand on. It would be nice, because in terms of democratic theory, one can imagine an argument that lame ducks should not be able to achieve what was achieved here. But the fact is that unlike a bill that is part of a proposed piece of legislation, which has been passed only by the 105th House, but not by the 105th Senate. That kind of thing clearly dies when the House of Representatives goes out. But unlike that, a bill of impeachment is a complete act, and it's an act that is given legal significance by the Constitution itself. Once there has been a vote of that kind, a vote to impeach, that automatically triggers power on the part of the Senate to conduct a trial.
Just for the record, are you and Professor Ackerman on opposite sides of this argument?
Yes. I mean, when I listened to his testimony, I must say I thought it was interesting and creative, but just not defensible. There are, after all, three judges who were impeached by the House, were then tried by the Senate in a subsequent Congress. One of them as recently as 1989. And the only argument that that Professor Ackerman or anybody could make about these instances is that they haven't really focused on the impact, as he says, of the 20th Amendment. Well, I've focused on the impact of the 20th Amendment. It's got nothing to do with it. It shortens the lame duck period, but it certainly does not bring us to a world in which, once the national election has been held, any subsequent action suddenly loses efficacy beyond that Congress. Otherwise, we'd have problems with Senate ratification of treaties. We'd have problems with confirmation of appointments. It's pretty clear in terms of precedent, in terms of text, in terms of the way the Constitution gives separately to the House and to the Senate the power to impeach and to try impeachments, that there is really no basis for treating an impeachment by the House as simply part of a proposal that lapses when the House goes out of session.
Why is it in the best interest of the country for the president to resign, saying, look, you know, I continue to believe in my innocence, that I did these things that I've asked for forgiveness for, but I didn't do anything that rose to the level of perjury or even certainly impeachable offenses, but in the good of the country, because it's a distraction, I should step down?
I think that kind of capitulation would underscore the dangerousness of the precedent that's been established. It would mean that a partisan impeachment that does not have general support in the nation, that is not based on conduct that, even if true, genuinely endangers the republic, can lead to the self-fulfilling prophecy of people saying, look, you've been impeached, that undermines your credibility, now why don't you leave? And if a president leaves in response to that kind of pressure, it seems to me he will simply be enhancing the temptation next time against a Republican president or a Democratic president to use the impeachment device as a way of not only censuring somebody, but of pressuring them out of office. And I think as a matter of principle, even if the president would rather be done with it all, he really has a kind of obligation to the nation to stay. And I think the
president would come to you and say, you know, I've been thinking about this, and not because of the things you pointed, not because I'm aware that if I sounds like I'm doing this because I was forced out by a partisan vote for impeachment, it would look bad. But I really believe that, you know, questions of character and questions go to the heart of what the presidency ought to stand for. On that basis, independent of an impeachment vote, I elect to step down. You would still oppose that because of what people might read into it, even though it wasn't true.
You know, not just might. I mean, I think it would require just an extraordinary suspension of disbelief. It's like standing in a corner and not thinking about a pink elephant. Very hard to do. Not noticing the rhinoceros in the room. It seems to me that when we have an impeachment of this kind for the president, who said all along that he would not resign, suddenly to leave and say, oh, by the way, it's not because of the impeachment, I think would just be inherently incredible. And I think that those who are telling the president that he owes it to the nation not to resign, I think are serious, and I think there's a lot in it. It's really because we do not want to enhance the power of one party, either political party, in a unilateral, absolutely obsessive way to drive someone from office by obtaining an impeachment and then building on it to generate pressure to leave. I think it would be very dangerous for the country, especially since there are alternatives that the Senate could fashion. That is, if the only alternatives were for the president to slink off under this kind of pressure and establish a terrible precedent on the one hand, or for us to go through the entire process of a trial in the Senate, ending with either acquittal or conviction on the other hand, and dislocate the country considerably in the meantime, then I think it might be a more closely balanced choice. But since there is a third way, an alternative in which the Senate and House together, through a joint resolution of censure, impose some serious burdens on the president that he then accepts by signing a joint resolution, bringing it all to a bipartisan end, I think that's a lot better for everybody. Because a bipartisan censure will, in the eyes of history, have some meaning, whereas a partisan impeachment may, in the eyes of history, not even stand as a scarlet eye on the president's forehead. And in a way, that's the worst of all worlds. It will not have achieved the purpose of expressing collective condemnation of what the president did, and yet it will establish a terrible precedent.
Professor Laurence Tribe, Harvard Law School, thank you very much.
Thanks, Charlie.
Pleasure. Back in a moment. Stay with us. After 4 days of bombing, the skies over Baghdad are quiet for now. But the reaction to the attack continues to make waves in Washington and around the world. The U.S. military announced that they had successfully struck 85% of their targets. The Iraqis are reporting numerous casualties, including both military and civilian victims. Joining me now from Washington to assess the mission and the motives behind it, Congressman Lee Hamilton of Indiana, the ranking Democrat on the House International Relations Committee. He'll be leaving Congress after a 34-year run, and I am pleased to have him again on this broadcast. Thank you very much, Congressman Hamilton, for joining us.
Nice to be with you, Charlie.
Tell me, I know you believe that this was the right thing to do. And I know you, and I think most reasonable people dismiss this link between that there was any motive that had anything to do with impeachment. But as to whether, in terms of the mission, the timing was right and the timing was sufficient to achieve the objectives, where do you come down on that?
Well, I think the timing is right, but I must say that's not so much a judgment of politicians or even presidents as it is of the military. They felt that the element of surprise was very important here. They felt that their forces, the American forces and the British forces, were ready to go on trigger alert. And quite obviously, Saddam Hussein had been thumbing his nose at us for quite a while. So I think there was a convergence of factors. We had a good bit of Allied support, if not explicit, then at least implicit. We wanted to go before Ramadan and not let Saddam Hussein have another 30 days or so to do his mischief. I think it was just a number of factors came together and made this an opportune time to strike.
Let's talk about surprise just for a moment, and certainly I'm not a military expert. Is there more surprise or less surprise when Butler delivers his report on Tuesday and you know that the United States has said that we're not going to give any warning next time, but if the Iraqis were watching developments, they would certainly think Butler's very strong condemnation would give the Americans and the Brits and whoever else joined incentive?
Well, of course, it's impossible to read the thinking of Saddam Hussein and the Iraqis. According to our military, according to our intelligence, we think they were surprised. There was a very narrow window, if you call it that, between Butler's report and the beginning of Ramadan. And the president, President Clinton, had made it quite clear that we were not going to attack or at least initiate the attack during Ramadan. I think Saddam Hussein, as nearly as I can tell, on the basis of reports, is thought he was home free for at least a few weeks, but we can't be sure what was going through his mind. In any event, our intelligence, our military people, think we caught him by surprise.
And how successful was the mission?
Well, of course, the administration did not set a very high standard for success, and everything depends, I guess, in a sense, on expectations. They said we wanted to degrade, that was the key word, the facilities of Saddam Hussein, particularly with regard to weapons of mass destruction and his ability to threaten his neighbors. By that standard, I think we achieved significant damage. 92 targets, I think about 91 of them were hit, 280 sorties, various degrees of damage to the SAM sites, the anti-aircraft installations, command and control centers, the facilities and the programs for weapons of mass destruction. We'll be evaluating this for some weeks to come.
But let me stop you there. Those kinds of targets seem to go to the idea of weakening Saddam Hussein and causing someone to get the notion that they can, in fact, topple him because his support forces are weakened.
Yes, I think that's one of the purposes, perhaps not explicit, but we'd be very pleased indeed if we weakened him to the point where some of his adversaries, internal or external, thought they could move against him.
But attacking his special guard does not go to the heart of destroying his means of producing weapons of mass destruction, does
it? That's very hard to do, to destroy his means of producing these weapons of mass destruction. With regard to the chemical and biological weapons, probably almost impossible to do because they can be done in such a small area all over the country, anywhere in the country. On the nuclear weapons, perhaps a little different. We did degrade, I think, reduced, lessened his capacity to deliver these weapons. Now, that's an important aspect of it as well. missile deliveries, and we think the missile sites were severely damaged. We must not overstate what we can achieve with a few days of bombing. You cannot accomplish great things. You remember during the Gulf War, we bombed for days and days and days and still had to send in the ground troops. So we have to be careful what we claim here. But we, I think, did delay at least his program, probably for a year, as the Secretary of Defense said today with regard to missiles, and we certainly set him back. But in terms of removing him or totally destroying his capability, we're far from doing that.
I'm intrigued by the notion of how important it is for the United States to act in the interest of its own credibility. And clearly this was at stake in this case because we pulled back in November.
I think trying to get a solution to these problems requires a very orchestrated relationship between politics and diplomacy on the one hand and the credible use of force or threat of the use of force on the other. We would like to solve these problems by diplomacy. But I think the record over years now makes it very clear that diplomacy not supported by a credible use of force just doesn't produce results. Now, the use of the force solves some problems, it creates other problems, but I think it is necessary. And I think a person like Saddam Hussein, he's not dumb, he's not stupid, is very skillful in understanding when we do in fact have a credible use of force present. In the past, he's often backed down, but not invariably. But it does take this orchestrated effort between diplomacy on the one hand and a credible use of force and the willingness to use that force to achieve our objectives.
Is there a downside to it
that
our allies will say, you know, you just say on the one hand, they'll say, you know, unless you can go in there and have a significant difference in his standing, then it's not a mission that you ought to undertake. Or B, people around the world say the United States is becoming too arrogant, thinking it can play the policeman of the world.
Well, you've set it out. There are certainly downsides here. The Arab countries are now going to have to deal with the Arab populations. They're not going to be happy that we went after Saddam Hussein. They always feel our policy is one-sided. The fact of the matter is, after the bombing, Saddam Hussein is still there. That's probably the biggest downside of all for us. But I think it's important to understand how difficult our problem is in dealing with Iraq. And, you know, so much of the talk in Washington today is let's remove Saddam Hussein from power, let's go after him. I think everybody wants to remove Saddam Hussein. The real difficulty is there is what price you're willing to pay. And so we have not been willing to pay the price of going into Baghdad, going into Iraq with massive forces in order to try to get him and to remove him.
What do you think is going to happen now?
I think you're going to see more of the same. That's a kind of a frustrating situation. We will continue to try to make the sanctions effective, to degrade his economy and make life more difficult for him. We'll keep that force, maybe increase it in the Gulf. Probably at some point down the line, we will have to use that force again. We hope to get established here. An inspection regime, but that becomes certainly doubtful now. Iraq is insisting they do not want an inspection regime. So it looks to me it's more of the same, a policy of containment that has a lot of frustrations. But let me make this point that I think is not generally appreciated. The vital interest of the United States in the Gulf is stability. It is getting the oil out of the Gulf. That is a vital interest. Every president I've ever known has described it as a vital interest. Vital means vital. It means that if we do not get that oil out, our life here, the lives of all of our friends and allies around the world are in danger. Our vital interests in the Gulf, with all of the frustration that we have towards Saddam Hussein, our vital interests are being accomplished. Would we like to get Saddam Hussein out? Of course we would. But there you come into this hard question of the ways and means and whether we're willing to pay the price to do it, and are we willing to accept the risks and the costs involved? And so far, the answer to that has been no.
Congressman Hamilton, as you leave the Congress, I want to thank you. I look forward to talking to you even beyond your date of departure from the Congress. You have been a wise voice in the arena of foreign policy, and it's always a pleasure to have you on the broadcast.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Nice to be with you.
Congressman Lee Hamilton, Democrat from Indiana, leaving the House of Representatives after some 30-plus years. Back in a moment. Stay with us. Nick Nolte is here. He is the star of two of the biggest films this holiday season. The first is a long-awaited film by director Terrence Malick, The Thin Red Line. It follows the story of an Army rifle company during the World War II Battle of Guadalcanal. Here is the trailer.
And there ain't no world but this one.
I've seen another world. Sometimes I think it was just my imagination.
If I go first, I'll wait for you there. On the other side of the dark waters. Why should I be afraid to die? I belong to you.
We're going straight up that hill, then.
How many men do you think it's worth? How many lives?
There's nowhere we can hide. Except in each other.
Killed a man. Worst thing you could do, nobody could touch me for.
Make no difference who you are. No matter how much training you got, how tough a guy you might be, you're in the wrong spot at the wrong time, you're gonna get it.
I want you to attack right now with every man at your disposal.
I've lived with these men, sir, for 2.5 years, and I will not order them all to their deaths.
Maybe all men got one big soul everybody's a part of. All faces of the same man.
What's your name?
What difference do you think you can make one single man in all this madness?
You're just too soft-hearted. You're not tough-fibered enough.
Have you ever had anyone die in your arms, sir?
Who lit this flame in us? Because I have you, nothing can touch me. No hurt, no grief, not even death.
Right now, I'm pleased to have Nick Nolte here to talk about The Thin Red Line. Welcome back.
Thank you.
I mean, I just want to know everything you can tell me about Malick.
All right. All right. Now, you got to understand this is my theory.
Yes,
of
okay.
Mr. Malick. So,
right.
I noticed a peculiar thing when we were in Australia, that when we would go out and shoot a scene, he would shoot the spine of the scene, and then he would leave it unfinished. And he would say, well, now, let's leave that and pick it up next week. So the actors were, a lot of the young actors were going, well, there's no way I can get back to the emotion of that. What are I, you know, how do I do this? So I would watch Terry, and the next week, and he'd be watching the sun, and about 5 o'clock, he would say, and the sun would turn orange, and he would say, well, let's go back and revisit this scene here. I think this is wonderful light, and we can shoot it over here. It doesn't match, but we'll shoot it over here. So what he was doing, he was ending all these scenes in this golden light, which if he had told the studio he only wanted to shoot between the hours of 4 and 8, they wouldn't have let him do the film. So not only was he getting this golden light, but Terry had said to me, he said, you know, I write a script, I want it to go past the script. I do a scene, I want it to go past what the actors think it is. The cinema photographer, I want it to go past the photography. My direction, I want it to go past my direction. I said, well, Terry, then you want some muse. And he said, yes, yes, yes. And so and in order to get Muse, it requires patience, time, you know, for something to sink in. So what he was doing, he was using these unfinished scenes as a steamroller underneath, because the actors would go back, pick up that scene, and they would always invariably bring something brand new to the scene. Their choice now was different than they would have made on the day. Terry had a week to think about the scene, and it evolved in his mind. So these things were underneath the film like this gear, which allowed this this idea of, let's wait for the truth to happen.
Yeah.
And I think that's what he was doing. Now, he might have just been...
just had his own style.
Yeah, just had his own style.
But do you think this has something to recommend to all of us?
Well, I do.
It works for him. Might it work for someone else?
Yes, I think the truth is not really readily approachable. And the more you drive at it, it's not there. And if you can find the patience or find some device to allow you the patience, sometimes it will appear. We were shooting a scene, and I could see out of the corner of my eye, Terry would watch the scene, and he would look up at this tree. And he was watching the scene, and look up this tree, and he'd watch the scene, and then we finished the scene. And he said, "Oh, that was all right. We'll pick that up in a second. But look at this tree. The caterpillars have eaten all the holes in the leaves." And he picked up his handheld camera, and he said to John Toll, "John, let's shoot this tree." And we spent the next half hour shooting this tree. Now, I haven't seen the film, but I hear that tree is in the film. Yes, and it looks like people have shot holes through it. So he always had his eye on nature and how it could possibly affect be affected by the war.
Fair to say he's different than anybody you've ever worked with.
Yes, fair to say.
Yeah. How did he call you? Did he call you up and just say, Nick?
No, Mike Medavoy called me and said, Terry'd like to meet with you. So I went and met with him, and I spent 4 hours. At that time, I was preparing James Jones for A Soldier Never Cries. So we talked James Jones, and he basically wanted to know how Hollywood had changed, you know.
Just for the benefit of the audience, I'm sure they know James Jones wrote The Thin Red Line.
Yes, right. And so at the end of that, he said, you know, I think you're too old for anything in Thin Red Line, except I want you in the film. So why don't you go home and research a general that we can place outside the battlefield so that we can see where these orders come in war, that they have nothing to do with the actual man getting killed. And I said, okay. And he said, then we'll have lunch once a week. I said, all right. So I went home, and I'm going through World War II, you know, and I'm
looking for your general.
Yeah, looking for the general, and I can't figure it out. But I'm coming up with something. So we have lunch. And on the fourth lunch, Terry said to me, he said, you know, you should play Colonel Tall. And I said, well, yes, I think I should, too. And we were at this place, and Mickey Rourke was standing over there. And he said, oh, I want Mickey Rourke in this film. I've talked to him, but he's the only actor Mike Medavoy won't have. But I want him in the film. So, Nick, go get Mickey. And so I brought Mickey over, and he said, Mickey, I want you in this film, but we won't let anybody know, and I'll just send you some money, and you fly on down. And so Mickey flew down and was in the film.
Great. Yes. Just come in. We won't tell Metaboy. Yes. We won't tell anybody.
Here's another beauty he did. John Savage had finished work, and Terry said to John, he said, you know, John, hey, if you don't have to go home, if you like it here, why don't you stick around? And the only thing I ask, come out at lunchtime, get in your combat fatigues, have lunch, and then hang around for an hour. If I don't use you within an hour, go on back to town and go to the bar, or go do whatever you want. And if you want to stay around, you're welcome to stay. And then John said, well, I love it here, I'll stay. So John would stay, and then we'd be shooting, and several days would go by, and he'd go back in town, and this one day we'd have smoke around, and he'd say, get John up here. And so John would come up, and he'd say, John, go into that smoke and rail against war. So John would go in there, and you killed Bobby, and you did this, and then this. And then he'd say, you two guys walk by him, and don't pay any attention. You two, this scares you. And they, so Savage stayed, I think, an extra month.
Why did he say he's directed so few films? Did you ever sit down and talk to him about the fact that...
No, you don't with Terry.
you don't first, with Terry.
No, because first of all, you get so engaged in a conversation of either philosophy or something that you never get around to why he has, you know, you just don't ever get to that subject. He's either, you're talking about life, you're talking about Homer, you're talking about birds, you're talking about this and everything. But you get the sense that, well, I said to Grant Hill when I was down in Australia, the producer, one of the producers, I said, you know, here's a man that does one film every 17 years. Now, if he waits another 17 years after this film, he'll be dead. And it's obvious that if he does one film every 17 years, he can't be making his living at film.
So
why would you assume he'd ever bring this film in on time? You know, what's the incentive? If it was me, I would just shoot forever.
He's having a good time.
Yes.
He's got some actors he likes.
Yeah.
He's telling this story. It's finding its own way.
Sure.
It may or may not get there.
Yes, right. So Grant got extremely upset and said, you can't say that. He's going to bring it in on time. He's going to bring it in.
Did he?
Yes, he did.
You don't believe that the film has been finished.
No, I know it hasn't been finished.
You know it hasn't?
No.
How do you know?
Because I was shooting a film, just finished a film, Simpatico, a Sam Shepard play.
Yeah.
And the cinema photographer was John Tall, who did Thin Red Line. And I know John would finish, we'd finish the day's work, he'd go home, and he'd wake up at 4 o'clock and go balance the film. And he had to balance it every night because Terry made changes every day. So this last Friday, he had made his changes, and I saw John, and I said, what happened? He said, well, he just made some more changes. And he said, we, 12 of us, got him and sat him down and said, all the editors and all of us, we sat there and said, you cannot change another frame. And he said, All right. But what he had been doing, all 12 had never been together. So if there were 4 of them there, he would say, the other 4 told me it was all right to make these changes. And so he was going in, and Hans Zimmer was adding music as of last week. So the film that everybody saw 2 weeks ago isn't the same film, I'm sure.
And you haven't seen it.
And I haven't seen it because I don't want to see it until he's done. And he has told me he has another 2.5-hour movie. There is 3 million feet of film.
That's great.
Which
he has another 2.5-hour movie that he can make later.
Later. And I think that would be marvelous because there are whole storylines from the book that we followed that I think would make an entirely another film viewpoint of that book of Thin Red Line. And Terry's and
how would you characterize him? If someone said, tell me, how would you define Terry?
Well, I would say that his mind is infinite. It just has no limits on it. And you immediately become engaged with that. And he just loves to listen. And that's a great quality that he has, that he listens, you know. And
ask a lot of questions?
Yes, ask questions, and he listens, and then he brings in these ideas, and he frames these ideas. And basically, that's how he worked around the film. He wouldn't approach it directly, but he would talk obliquely. One day he came to me, and he said, here, I've written this, and it's a couple of pages of this, and I want you to read it. And I said, okay. And I said, I'll take it to my trailer. And he said, no, read it right now. And don't show it to anybody because I haven't had a chance to work on it, and I don't want to work on it, but I want you to read it. So I'm looking at it, and I see this Eros Rhododactylos. And I said, well, what is that, Terry? And he said, that's Latin for rosy finger dawn. And I said, okay. And then I'm reading, and this poem, and this is a beautiful poem I'm reading. And I said, well, this is a wonderful poem. I said, well, what's this from? He said, Homer. I said, oh, okay. And he said, now, it's 2 pages long. It's too long, so you edit it the way you like it. And then maybe one day you'll look up at the sky and say, Eros Rhododactylos, and you know, and so he was adding this poetry and all.
So one day you might be inspired on the set.
Yes.
While the cameras are on.
Yes, or Terry might be inspired and say, what a wonderful sky. Nick, why don't you stand up against the sky and say that little poem, you know, which we did. You know.
All right, roll tape. Here's a scene from the Thin Red Line.
You get a man to him right now with orders to attack, and you move him by the flank to the ridge. Then you get that second platoon, you move him over to the hill. Have him press the center. Go straight up that damn Hill. You attack them right now. I have to give you a heads up, Mrs. What is it?
Colonel, I don't think that you fully understand what is going on down here. My company alone cannot take that position, sir. The Japs are too well dug in. They've got too much firepower. Colonel, there's a bunker up there. We can't see it, and it's chewing my men to pieces, sir. I formally request to be given permission for patrol reconnaissance around to the right of Hilton, through the jungle. I believe the entire position, sir, can be outflanked with a maneuver there in force.
No! Damn it, I tell you no! There'll be no flanking move! Now listen to me, Starros. You're not gonna take your men around into the jungle to avoid a damn fight! Now do you hear me, Starros? I want you to attack. I want you to attack right now with every man at your disposal. Now attack, Starros! That's a direct order!
Sir, I must tell you that I refuse to obey your order.
I've been watching that, and I said to you, does he direct much? And you said, no, he just gets you to the scene.
Yes, he gets you to the scene. That scene is the argument of Tall, the military man, saying, get the objective. If you don't give, if you stall, you die. Really, there's a self-interest driving underneath that. Starros is arguing the argument of human compassion. I don't want to jeopardize my man's life any more than I have to. The question is there any place on the battlefield for human compassion? And that's James Jones' question. Of course, Jones, you know, the interesting thing about Jones, when he was shot in Guadalcanal, that day he said he knew he was going to die, not only intellectually, from a gut level. And the fellow next to him knew that he was going to die that day. And he said, when you know that, there's a tremendous fear that overwhelms you. And when this fear comes upon you, it really just shatters all of your social conditioning, your facade, your personality. And he said everything was shattered. And what was left in that moment was an unbearable compassion of love for my fellow man. And so this was a kind of theme that resonates through it. And you see that in Jones's life, because you see later on in his life how he championed the common man, and he felt this connection to them. So, but Terry would, the way Terry would prepare you is, I shot a scene with John Travolta, and Terry asked me what I wanted to say on the boat with the general, and I said, as little as possible. And he said, okay. So he wrote 3 pages of monologue for John. And he said, we should have dinner with John because it's, you know, just to say hello and all this. And John, right off the bat, said, well, do you want me to memorize all of this? And Terry said, well, if you want to. And he said, well, it's a lot. Could I use cue cards? And Terry said, if you want to, it's all right. And John said, well, that's a really lot. And Terry said, well, here's what I would do if I were you. I would just use this as an outline and say my own words. And John said, oh, I don't think I can do that. And I said to John, it'll be all right. So when we went to shoot it, John, a couple of takes, it took him to get in the rhythm, and boom, he went right through it. He did it wonderful, and we shot for 3 hours. And Terry said, well, I think we've got it. So the next day we're on the boat, both John and I, we have one more day on the boat. And as we're going in, Terry said to us, let's go upstairs and revisit that scene we shot. And he said, this time, let's do it without saying a word. Only except move exactly where you moved, but don't say a word. So John and I looked at each other, and we walked over here, and we stood, looked at each other, and looked out at the sea, and took out a cigarette, and gave it to John, and lit his, he lit mine. We walked over here, looked out, walked over here, and as we're staring at the back of Catalina Island, which was supposed to be Guadalcanal, we hear Terry from behind camera say, there it is, the rock. So John said, there it is, the rock. In silence, Terry said, walk away, John. John walked away. That was the scene.
Now, what's going to make the cut?
I don't know.
You don't know.
I will.
See, this is going to be a fun movie for you to watch.
Yes,
because
yes.
You don't really know what movie you've made.
No, no. No. And that's great filmmakers.
Terry may not either, but yes. We don't know.
No, you don't know. That's great filmmakers. It's impossible to know how Martin Scorsese is going to view a scene. And when you come in and see the way Marty has set up the camera, and one day he set up a camera, and there was about five mirrors in it. And when I looked at it, I didn't even know where I was to stand or look or anything, and all Marty did was laugh. And he said, well, really, there's a speck right here. You have to look there. Now, you won't be able to see anything, and you have to play the whole scene. So, you know, and there's no way you can visualize what it will be.
One more scene. Take a look. Thin red line. Here it is.
I don't know if you realize the importance of this operation, Starros. Once our position is secured, we can move the bombers in. That means air power for 1,000 miles in every direction. Guadalcanal may be the turning point in the war. It'll cost lives, Starros. Is that what's troubling you?
No, sir.
I'll explain to you the importance of this objective. How many men do you think it's worth? How many lives?
I can't say, sir.
Are you prepared to sacrifice the lives of any of your men in this campaign? How many? 1, 2, 20? Lives will be lost in your company, Captain. And if you don't have the stomach for it, now is the time to let me know.
You know, sir, you're right. About everything you said.
Fine. Fine, that's all, Captain. One more thing, Starros. It's not necessary for you to ever tell me that you think I'm right. Ever. We'll assume it. Dismissed.
Nick Nolte, thank you for coming.
Yeah.
The film is A Thin Red Line. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Time magazine announced its 1998 Men of the Year as President Clinton and independent counsel Kenneth Starr. The two were chosen for their impact on the news and on history. The president was previously Time's Man of the Year in 1992 when he was elected. Joining me now to talk about this year's selection, Walter Isaacson, our friend and Time magazine's managing editor. Welcome.
Thanks. Good to be back.
Good to have you here. The obvious question is why these two?
Boy, you know, they embraced in this muddy, sullied embrace where they each reflected each other's worst values and worst instincts, and they're going to be paired in history. And you've had, for the first time in 130 years, the impeachment of the president, and it came not just because of what one of them did, but how both of them interacted. It's going to be this strange coupling, this pairing, this Les Miserables type thing for the
ages. It's not yin and yang, but it is something like these two opposites that are compelled in mortal combat with each other.
Absolutely opposite values. There's a very interesting thing. We talked to Kenneth Starr quite a bit, and he talked about the first time he met Bill Clinton. Starr was about 33 years old and was studying for the bar exam in Washington, and Bill Clinton was at the hotel there as a Arkansas governor for the National Governors Conference. And Starr rode the elevator with him and watched him, and he had followed Clinton's career, and he found him charming and larger than life, but the type of person who cut corners and sort of skated by. And it sort of offended Ken Starr, but he was also awed and fascinated by it.
Interesting. Clinton has said, not here, but he said in the past to people who have been quoted as saying, this thing is going to be, in the end, he's out to get me, and it's going to be the last man standing, and I intend to be that man. Now, is it Clinton standing, or is it Ken Starr standing? Or is it both standing?
I think they've both brought all of Washington down, and I think the rest of us in the country are just shaking our heads. I mean, it's like they've reduced Washington to being like a classroom of fifth graders where they're all kind of hyperactive and pointing fingers, and somebody from my home state of Louisiana, Bob Livingston, gets knocked into the gutter this past week. And you just wonder, maybe they should, you know, put Ritalin in the water supply or something down there. But it's not just two men wrestling now. It's this whole city that's been torn apart.
This was an early on idea. Did you have doubts about it? Were there moments in which you said, no, it's not these two. In fact, it's Hillary. Was it a factor that determined that it had to be them? Was it, for example,
we went right down to the wire. Usually we have these things organized and printed well in advance. We had spent a lot of time looking at Hillary Clinton as a woman of the year. And, you know, sentimentally, I would love to have done that. She fascinates me. I respect her. And I thought maybe she symbolized the way we saw the scandal, that sort of through her eyes and through her dignity, we were going to get out of this scandal. But in the end, the criteria we use is who had the most impact on history, who had the most impact on the news in our times. And when it shifted, in early November, we thought there would not be an impeachment vote after the midterm elections. But when it shifted to being obvious that they were going to impeach the president, we shifted away from, we have a very interesting story on Hillary Clinton because we spent, you know, a couple of months researching what her year has been like. But in the end, these two people had the impact on history because the impeachment finally happened.
And you had to include both of them.
I think they're joined. I mean, it's not as if one of them did this. I mean, Bill Clinton was the one who got into this mess, who evaded and cut corners and misled people. And Starr saw it, thought it was a crime, and pursued it not only into the Oval Office, but into the private study. And so without both of them acting together, you wouldn't have had this drama.
Mark McGuire on the list?
Oh, yeah. And, you know, there was a moment this year, you know, when the scandal seemed to be receding, where I thought we'd think of 1998 and Mark McGuire would pop into our heads, just like when we think 1961, Roger Maris pops into our heads. And Mark McGuire came by our offices, I guess it was in November. And I tell you, you got a lot of nonchalant journalists at Time Magazine, but when he came down the corridor to the office, everybody is coming out of the offices just to bask in his smile. And he posed for some great pictures, spent a lot of time talking to us. So in some ways, in this issue this week, that there are two other interesting stories, Hillary Clinton and Mark McGuire.
So you were prepared to go that way if history had not been so...
Yeah, if history had not been so rude to us.
Could you have put an athlete on the cover as Man of the Year?
Yeah, I think so. In fact, I sort of regret that over the 70-some-odd years we've done Man of the Year, there have been great athletes, but we generally don't... We've never done an athlete as Man or Woman of the Year. And, you know, I look at Babe Ruth or Joe DiMaggio or Jackie Robinson, and I think maybe they should have been... Men or Women of the Year.
I read too much on this program, but Nancy Gibbs has written
She's absolutely brilliant.
It is the most, I think, the best written thing of its kind that I have seen in terms of year-end summing up where we are. She begins by saying, we treat our values like our children, not equally but uniquely, and we don't like having to choose which one we would sacrifice to save another. Which matters most, honesty or privacy, justice or mercy, the president or the presidency? What punishment is reserved for leaders who would force such choices in the first place? Bill Clinton did something ordinary. He had an affair and lied about it. Ken Starr did something extraordinary. He took the president's low-life behavior and called it a high crime. I mean, on and on, she captures just...
That's what we try to do at, you know, Time Magazine and other places, to say, this has been hitting us all year. But let's think about it for a moment, try to digest it. You know, Nancy Gibbs, Nation editor Priscilla Payton, and Steve Kep, and Karen Tumulty, and Michael Weisskopf, and Michael Duffy, they've all been working on this for months and months and months. And then finally last week, we stepped back a bit. We said, what ideas emerge from this? How will history remember this year?
What's the role of a news magazine today in the world of 24-hour television, in the world of newspapers, which more and more and more like this one give you context every day?
The role of a news magazine is, after you've been hit with headlines every hour. I mean, last week was a bombardment the likes of which only Baghdad has seen, with missiles of headlines hitting us every hour. The role of a news magazine is to do what Nancy Gibbs and all the rest of the people did at Time last week and say, here's the narrative tale. Here's what happened behind the scenes. And here's a way to process it in a moral way, to understand the ethical issues involved. It's funny, people thought news magazines were, you know, going to be dinosaurs in the age of television. But it's network television.
But it's a new role.
It's a new role where we get behind the scenes and do narrative storytelling mm-hmm. in a way that interests people, in a way that says, hey, you're going to find this fascinating. Let me tell you a story. And that's why Time Magazine is stronger than it's been for years because of the role I think we play.
Time Magazine, Men of the Year, Kenneth Starr and Bill Clinton. It's an interesting issue of this magazine, giving a real sense of how we got there and what the real issues are that are at stake as this drama continues. My thanks to Walter Isaacson, managing editor of Time Magazine. Thank you.
Thank you, Charlie.
Thank you for joining us. See you tomorrow night.
USA Networks as part of our continuing commitment to innovative television. Through USA Network and the Sci-Fi Channel, we provide original entertainment to America and the world.
Anywhere, anytime, any book. BarnesandNoble.com, where the world shops for books.
Cisco Systems, the company that brought the internet to business, is pleased to help bring The Charlie Rose Show to PBS. Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order Charlie Rose program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.